Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air, but first, the daily contemplation. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was simplest Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior, totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be tamed, both teacher and guide of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma, visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, inviting each and everyone to come and see for themselves, inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and everyone through progress towards perfection. Directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. Perfectly training is this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples. They are training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore, to these eight kind of individuals, these four noble pairs deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation with joined palms. Since this noble Sangha community of the Buddhist noble disciples is an unsurpassable and indeed forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, uphold, and protect. Thank you. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air number 47. Recorded on the 17th July, no, December 2016, in a rainy weather, so we are undercover today. Still outside, but undercover. There are four questions and one simile, but first a normal intro. Namo, tasso, bhagavato, arahato, samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. We take the simile first, as usual. I will expand with a Kamma story, a Kamma report from earlier times. There are tons of them in the text. So first we take a simile, then we take three questions, and then a Kamma story in the end, as a raisin in the sausage. So those who wait until the end, they will get the good story, the juicy part. But nevertheless, this for next time, huh? This time is the simile of the six-gated city. It's from the Samyutta Nikaya, the connected discourses of the Buddha, which you see here. Book 35, Sutta, or thread number 245. he explained to Bhikkhu that it's like this, if you seek purification of view, of right view, samadhi, purity of view, purity of vision, to see it as it really is, to see it as it really becomes, jnana bhuta dasana, jnana bhuta jnana, knowing it as it really becomes. So there's this six-gated city. There's six gates. And there's an intelligent and vigilant gatekeeper. And he lets only those in he knows, while those who are strangers, those he reject. Then two messengers, swift messengers, they come by a certain road, and they ask him, where's the lord of the city? And then he say, there's an intersection of these six inroads from these six gates in the center of the city. There's the lord of the city. Then they pass the gate and go and deliver an important message about reality to the lord of the city. And then they pass back where they came from at the same, from the same way. So they came from the north. Then two messengers come from the south, from the east and from the west. So in all, four pairs of messengers come to this lord of the city and give him an important message. And the simile goes like this. The city is like the body, because the city is made of stone and clay and the four elements, solidity, fluidity, heat and motion. And so is this body also. And the city will fall apart if it's not maintained, and so will this body also. And the city will fall apart eventually in all cases, whether maintained or unmaintained, and so will this body also. The six gates are like the six sense doors. The eye, the ear, the nose, the tongue, the skin, and the mind itself. So there are six doors that leads into the mind. The intelligent and vigilant gatekeeper is mindful awareness, sati, that watch out for any stranger coming there, because both good and evil will pass in and out of one of these six doors, one of these six gates. The strangers and the spies and the evildoers, they will come in through one of the gates. And so also the temptations and the aversions and whatever provoke the mind to do evil, it will come in and pass out of one of the sense doors. So these have to be guarded. Then there's the two messengers. This is like calm and insight, the two main arms of Buddhist praxis and training, calm, samatha, and insight, vipassana. They come and deliver a message to who? To the lord of the city. Who's the lord of the city in this city? It's consciousness. Consciousness sits in the middle and receive all the information that comes in through the eye, the ear, the nose, the tongue, or the body, or the mind itself. So these messages are coming. What is the message? This is a message about reality, about how it really becomes, about suffering, about craving as the cause of suffering, about absence of craving as the end of suffering, about the Noble Eightfold Way as a method to end suffering. That's a message, an important message. What are the four directions symbolizing? They are symbolizing the four frames of reference for this mindfulness that looks out. It looks out for certain things and put it in certain perspectives, namely these four frames of reference, the four satipatthanas. So it looks at form, it sees it as a frame. If it looks at a body, it sees just as a form or a frame. Doesn't see it as me, as mine, or you, or they. Sees as a frame. If it looks at a feeling, then it's just a reactive response. So form, body as form, feeling as response, mind as moods. If it see any mental state, any kind of mind or mentality, whether anger, jealousy, hesitation, doubt, uncertainty, gladness, generosity, good as bad, then it sees as a mood. It's a passing mood that comes and goes. If it see any phenomena, whether internal or external, whether material or mental, past, present or future, it see I as a mental state. It's just a mental state. It's not an absolute reality out there, independent of the mind. It's perceived through mind, therefore it's ultimately speaking a mental state. The universe is a mental state. This thing is a mental state, that thing is a mental state, this video is a mental state. It's the only witness that you have that this is real. It's a mental state, the mental state that you have right now, that your mind is in right now, and which already have passed. So the four frames of reference, again, seeing the body as a frame, the feeling as a response, the mind as mood, and the phenomena as mental states, neither more nor less. These are the four directions. So this message of reality that they deliver, this messenger that comes in and out this door, that has passing, that the gatekeeper he lets in, because those he know is like the good mental states. He let them in and pass into consciousness, like generosity, kindness, knowledge, certainty, understanding, compassion, pity, so forth. Advantageous, skillful, wholesome mental states and attitudes. He lets in so they can pass into consciousness. But the other one, the strangest, the evil one, envy and jealousy, miserliness, anger, hate, opposition, and so on. This he rejects. They are not allowed to come close to consciousness. So when the messengers come in and deliver this message about how it really becomes, Yada Buddha, Jnana, the knowledge of how it really becomes, then it's a message about Nibbana. So it's an important message about reality. So goes the simile of the six-gated city, which is worth remembering because this is also a six-gated city, complete with ramparts and hopefully also a fairly vigilant and intelligent gatekeeper. Remember the gatekeeper and the messengers and the message. Now we go to the questions. Question 162. Who decides the duties of the devas, for example, Yama and his hell attendants? And what is their kamma? Yama is three level up, and he and his kingship and those who are around him, they have a kind like a night watch job. They go and torture people in hell. So at daytime, they are delighting in divine pleasures, and at nighttime, usually disguised as animals or all kinds of things, because they are not very proud of being torture chamber attendants down there at night. So they disguise themselves. They're not exactly shameful of it, but nevertheless they disguise themselves for those who torture and for each other. So why are they there? They are there because of this very subtle relation between mental states and physical reality. They are there. There are no one who decides their duties. They are decided by nature itself, how nature works. You can say, as long, how has they come there? They come there because of Kamma, and their whole realm has arised because of Kamma. What is that Kamma? It is those who see those who are wrongdoers, who are really wrongdoers, so they are right on that one, and then they punish them. And then they also do a lot of good at the same time. So they are rightful punishers and good doers. They will become Yamas. And as long as they are good meditators, then there will be Brahmas also. As long as there are those who make the bodhisattva vow in front of a Buddhist feet and say, I will work for the freedom of all beings and happiness of all beings until I attain supreme enlightenment, so I can teach them this freedom, this peace, this highest happiness. Yeah, then there will also come Buddhas. And as long as there are somebody who commits crimes like killing and various other things, then there will also be hells. So this level of existence, of which there are 31, they are created by certain probabilities that makes these potentialities of material states, they emerge because there is a observer-dependent and thereby karmically related probability for them to emerge. What is their karma? Yes, their karma is, as long as they delight and do it intentionally, then they will go down on it. And they should often see the same thing, as long as there are heroes, but they are at the same time a very perverse hedonist, ultra hedonist, then there will be martyrs, Satan in Christian terminology. So he is on a fairly high level, the highest level you can come in the sense desire realm. So he done significantly good. So he was also almost frighteningly intelligent, but at the same time, then he's very hedonistic and very perverse. So this creates this realm of beings that has this political motive to promote sense desire to the highest happiness at whatever cost. You just take your pleasure. If somebody else died, doesn't matter. Pleasure is the highest goal in life. This is a prime political motive. So as long as there are beings who has this view, take up this view, which is not far from normal people's view, because normal people are also hedonistic. They will say, I'll take whatever pleasure that comes my way, and that's the happiness in life. So they hunt sense pleasures. They hunt to see sense pleasure by the eye. It can be porn, it can be film, it can be modern art, or by the ear, music. By the tongue, taste, sushi, for example, or by the nose, perfume, by touch, sex, and by mind, mental states, intoxicated mental states, smoking marijuana, or drinking alcohol, or cocaine, or something like that. So it's propel them along this way of sense desire. Very common. The question is, how far you go, how much it should cost other beings that you get your pleasure. So whether one takes one's pleasure on other beings' account, so they have to pay for one's own pleasure. And that's where the ethical problem comes in. And there, Mara says, doesn't matter. You just take what you can get, basically. Whatever cost it has for other beings, it doesn't cost you anything. And that's because he don't know, or maybe he don't want to admit to himself, that all Maras, unambiguously, after having been Mara, after having been Satan, then they go to hell. So they come from a fairly high state. It's level 11, and we are level 5. So 6 level high up, and then he go all the way down to 4 levels under us, screaming in a barbecue. So he goes to Avicii hell, the hell without break, without pause. Same goes for, you can say, if you look at the animal scale, it's actually fairly common, and also in the case of those who are torturers, the Yama Devas, They have done some good, so they have been hired, but then they have this night job, this night watch in the torture basement of samsara, where they have to do a job to punish the wrongdoers. Same thing if you're, let's say, being born as a predator animal. The predator animal, it can be a spider that eats other insects alive, slowly, very cruel, huh? Or can be a tiger, or any predator actually. Then they will kill and eat what they eat lifelong. They will kill and eat them alive. And because of that, they will go further down. So they are born on a certain state, but the behavioral pattern in this certain state, unless they go forcefully against it, then they will propel them further down. In this regard, there's a story about Saka who had, he has many wives, and he had one who he was in particular in love with. And then he saw she should die the same day. And then he, in order to get her back in his world, he told her this, now you're going to die. and you'll be a heron. You'll be born as a bird on planet Earth among the humans. But don't eat anything fish alive. You take the fish, and if it wriggles with its tail, then you let it go. Don't eat any live fish. Only eat dead fish. And then you can come back here to me. And she was also very much in love with him. So she promised to do as he said. Then she died and appeared as a heron, a white heron, in this rice field, going around and looking for frogs and small fish. And then Sakka, he decided to test her. And then he looked, he made himself into a small fish lying, floating around with his belly up, looking stiff in the water. And then she came there as a heron and picked it up. And as soon as she picked it up, then he started wriggling with the tail. And then she let it go. Then he dumped back into, he says, she will come because she do as I say. So he tested her. Huh? Experimental evidence. Insist on that. So she pined away because she didn't get much to eat, obviously. And then she died and was reborn in his company. So the plan, the scheme, actually was successful in this case. So being born as a predator entails, if you don't go against it, going further down. And this also, being born as a Yama Deva, you have some pleasure, but if you keep torturing this and don't forgive anybody, then you go further down after that. I hope this answered the questions. Question 163. My mother supports a relative who hurts her verbally. What should she do? Yes, at first we look at this family situation from a little bit from outside, because this is obviously a family problem. She gives funds to this relative in another country, and then she's abused verbally in the phone and become depressed after that. But there can be many similar problems between relatives, close or remote. They also come under the heading family problems. And there's a saying here, as far as I understood, that the Singhalese culture is, the saying goes like something like this: if there's no problem, then it's not a family. If there's no family problems, then it's not a family, basically. So it means that, if you have a family, then you also have problems. And this is not something one can escape. And having a family or family relation, the Devas don't have family, but they have family relations, you can say, social relations, which are family-like. If you want to escape this problem of family relations, the only way to go is to go Nibbana, because there you don't have any family. You're not in association with anybody. So it's a naive expectation to be in a family and then say, it'll be harmony all the way from day zero to the coffin. That's never the case, never the case. Neither between son or father, or between daughter or mother, or between father and mother, or married couples, or whatever kind of family relations there is, there will be problems. Multiple, many problems. As there is problems between human beings and beings in general. As soon as there's two bracelets on the same arm, they will cling. Huh? If there's only one bracelet, then they will not cling. That's why I live alone, in peace and ease, relatively speaking. So, who ordered this situation that you're being born into a family? Who ordered this pile of excrement? This family pile of excrement, pile of doom? Yes, we did ourselves. We did ourselves. It's not the relatives' fault that we are being born into a family. This is our own mistake, you can say, further upstream. So this whole family issue, that one has a family that can make problems and will make problems, a never-ending row of problems. Who ordered this plate? Who ordered this cake? We did. Huh? So since you ordered it yourself, now is the time to eat it. Eat the dung, eat the excrement, eat the problems. So that's a general issue, you can say, about the whole family situation. Same thing goes with job. Same thing goes with friends. There is just problems. And this is not escapable anywhere else than going Nirvana. I'm heading right up there. So if you want to trail me, you're very welcome. Very welcome. I have no naive expectations about a problem-free family or friends or associations of any kind whatsoever. Next is how actually to deal with the pragmatically with the problem at hand. There, one should use, of course, patience, which is mental perfection, kanti parami, and then also piti, karuna, compassion, understanding. So give people a second chance and a third chance. The Buddha say actually you should give people six chances. There's a saying among, or a rule in Buddhist discipline for monks that says like this: if a lay person or another monk, actually also can be any person, they are disrespectful towards six things: the Buddha, the Dhamma, the Sangha, morality, concentration, and the training. If they're disrespectful towards one of these six things, then we're not allowed to teach them. You don't need to be angry at them. You don't teach them. Don't say anything to them. Don't teach them anything, any Dhamma. Then they have to run out their line and see what this brings. And this is, in all cases, suffering. And this can also be applied to personal friendships and to family relationships. If persons are abusive, disrespectful, abusive, or ungrateful, as in this case, she's supported or he is supported, this family relation is supported by money, but still verbally abuse the giver, the donor, the family donor in the telephone. So this mother becomes in a bad mood. After having given, she's kind of scolded. Huh? So if disrespectful, abusive, or ungrateful, then one should avoid contact. Not be angry, not try to go into revengefulness or anything like that. Just avoid contact. Because as soon as there's no contact, clock, then the problem is finished. No contact, no problem. No family contact, no family problem. It's as he says that. And then one should give people these six chances to come back in another attitude than any attitude that could be called abusive, disrespectful, unfriendly, ungrateful, or unthankful. And if they do that, then one give them a second chance. One don't need to give them a seventh chance. If they do become disrespectful or abusive again, which often happens actually, yeah, then one give them a second chance, a third chance, fourth chance, and a sixth chance, but not a seventh chance. Six times is game over. So this is, I think, very fair ruling, huh? Six times is game over. You don't come back the seventh time being abusive and then ask for forgiveness. Then go somewhere else with your bad habits. So six times forgiveness, patience, compassion, good spirit, good will. Say, okay. But not the seventh. And in between these six times, one should wait a significant period for things to settle, for the dust to settle in these conflict situations, and then see what comes out. In between these conflict, one just avoid contact. Avoid contact. This is the best. It's also very protective towards oneself, because this abuse and disrespect that comes flowing from this other person for this or that reason, this stops immediately because there is no contact. There's no canal that the excrement can flow into your presence at or by. So avoid any kind of contact. This is kind of the key to avoid these situations. Until this person has turned around and see such mistake, if this happens. If it doesn't happen, then it doesn't happen. Then it doesn't happen. This can take sometimes years for people to see, I was unreasonable there. It was not the other person who was to be blamed. It was not the giver the donor, the helper that was to be blamed. It was me that was ungrateful or disrespectful or abusive. I have to go back and make an apology to this my relative, my friend, or my associate or fellow or whoever it is. It was my own mistake that I was cut off by the root. So much for question 163, 27 minutes in. 164, what is the Buddhist perspective on the United States election of president and how to practice with fear and anxiety? The presidential election I will avoid commenting on because I think very strongly that a monk should not participate in politics in any kind of way, neither directly nor indirectly. And as soon as you start commenting on politics, then you are participating in politics. So I'll not say anything about this US election whatsoever. However, I will say something that has bearing not only on the US election, but on leaderships in general today. Because Buddha said something about that in a series of speeches he called Future Dangers. It's also in the Samyutta Nikaya, in the Connected Discourses. And there he amongst said that there will be a time, which is now, that the good guys, they will be pushed out. They will withdraw themselves out of the dogfight and the mudslinging. And then they will not get themselves leadership. So they will wisely withdraw, and thereby those who become leaders will be the bad guys. Those who become leaders by phoning and making tricks and canvassing and so on, pressing other people, oppressing other people, economically, politically, in many ways, in whatever way they can gain power. And this goes inside the Sangha, outside the Sangha, in politics, on the job, in academia, on the university, on the school, everywhere it's the same. You see leaders today that are not worthy of being leaders, bosses or directors, because they are mental qualities, properties and hindrances are such that they are should not be leaders. They will favor or others, they will direct under the influence of greed, hate, ignorance, and fear. And that is not good leadership. Then you make unjust decisions. And this you can see all over the place, all over the place. You can say, actually, it is wise to bow down and withdraw out of this dogfight. Because now the dogfight has become dirty in our time. It has become dirty. And you cannot participate in this dogfight of power, of leadership, without getting blood on your hands. Because you have to do the dirty tricks to become a leader today. You have to do the dirty tricks. You cannot become a leader with clean hands. It's impossible. And that's actually because of the karma. It's better then to say, okay, then I don't need to be leader. I don't need to be boss. And let those who want to fight the dogfight about this rotten piece of meat, rotten piece of leadership meat, let them fight about it. I withdraw. This way is worth noticing that Nekkhamma, withdrawing out, instead of involving, then pulling out, withdrawing back from society, from involvement, from taking power or getting a position. This is the second mental perfection, Nekkhamma parami, withdrawal, the opposite of involving. So much for this one. How should one practice with fear and anxiety? I'll just say that these unworthy leaders that become leaders because they wisely back out of the mess. Otherwise, they wouldn't stand the competition. And then they get this leadership through evil and corrupt ways. they, of course, because of this evil of corrupt ways, they are acting with, after having become leaders on the high position, then they get powers to do something that they couldn't do before on the low position. But since they are under the influence of mental defilements, and we should look at this with great pity, then they act in a way that will lead to a karmic downfall. So they are digging up their own root, basically, by coming to this high position, having a desire to come into power. Because when they abuse this power, then it's a karmic crash. Later downfall, inevitable. Nevertheless, how to practice with fear and anxiety? Yes, fear and anxiety, the medicine and antidote against that is corpse meditation, which induce fearlessness of death. And since death is kind of like the highest fear, then if you become fearless of death, then you also become fearless of all smaller fears, like losing your job, losing your lover, losing your money or bank account or car or whatever. So all these minor anxieties of oppression, for example, in a political situation, or whatever it can be, they disappear if one loses the highest fear, which is fear of death. And this one can lose by this corpse meditation. And the classic text goes like this. Is one should visualize a corpse from a picture, or at best from a real corpse one can see, human or animal, not of the same at the same sex of oneself. If one is heterosexual, if one is homosexual, one should look at a skeleton. But the best Buddha, he said like this. This is from the Kayagata Sati Sutta, which is Majjhima Nikaya, the middle length discourses of the Buddha, number 119. If a monk sees a corpse 1, 2, or 3 days dead, swollen, blue, festering, thrown into a cemetery, he then uses this experience regarding his own body. Really, exactly so is also this, my own body. It is of the same nature. Just so will this body become disgusting. It cannot escape this fate of becoming blown up, bluish, and infested with maggots. If a monk sees a body thrown in a cemetery being eaten by crows, hawks, vultures, dogs, jackals, or by a variety of worms and maggots, if a monk sees a corpse reduced to a skeleton with some flesh and blood still attached to it and held together by sinews, or if a monk sees a cadaver, a blood-smeared skeleton, but without any flesh, without any muscle or fat tissue left, held together by tendons as a chain of bones, or if a monk sees a carcass, just a skeleton, without any flesh or blood, but yet still held together by just the tendons. If a monk sees a skeleton simply bleached like white shell, like bones, if a monk sees a bare bone thrown in a cemetery, lying heaped up with a skull on the top, if a monk sees a stack of bones now got rotten and turning into dust, he then applies this experience to his own body. Ah, verily, and exactly so is also this my own body. It is of the very same nature, fragile and feeble. It will inevitably turn into dust, and it cannot ever escape this fate. If he does that, then he lives fearless, detached, clinging to nothing in this world. So this is a way to induce fearlessness. It is to meditate on corpses. One can meditate on one's own body as a corpse, or one can visualize corpses. And there you can go to my website and search for corpse meditation. And then I put a lot of corpse pictures up in a photo bucket site where there's a password. You can see that on the website. Then pick out the most revolting, disgusting, shocking corpse picture there is, and then memorize that in all detail, how the form, shape, color, look of it is, how the details are, how the context of the details are on the picture of this corpse. And then turn mind to that. Often, doing meditation, especially when desire comes in and lust and greed for this or that comes in. Then slowly fearlessness comes according to the effort invested. In this regard, I was sitting in London. At that time, I was employed as associate professor there, and I was sitting in my small room, an apartment I had there, sitting on the floor meditating. And then I saw my own body as a skeleton from the side, a little from above. It was clear to me that this was my own skeleton. I saw it as kind of like with the X-ray vision, visualized that for my closed eyes. So you can say I have a kind of like an out-of-body experience where I could see my own skeleton sitting on the floor as a visualization behind my closed eyes. Could see it in my mind. Then suddenly, out of nowhere, then the cranium fell off and fell down in the lap. And then still there was this skeleton sitting, meditating, cross-legged, with the skull in the lap. And this, for some reason, I found this hysterically funny and had to giggle several minutes. And still when I think it now, still think it's funny. So seeing your own body as a dead body, as a corpse, when you can laugh at that, then you're fearless. You don't fear death. And this also I can say, I don't fear death at all. It'll be party time. So then all these worries about the presidential elections and taxation and rapist and the big black man outside or the snake under the bed, whatever it can be, they evaporate into insignificance. This fear, anxiety goes away, simply. It goes away. It takes, I would say, considerable effort, depending upon how much attachment, how much clinging there is, because this fear and anxiety is induced by attachment and clinging to various kinds of things, to the world, to one's apartment, to being alive, to have this or that social status, to be in this or that family, to have so and so much on your bank account, or whatever it can be, and a multitude of many other issues. Jungled up, fused up, and mixed into a juice, a clinging juice. Not very tasty. But fear, as soon as you just take a small sip of it, then you have a large dose of fear and anxiety. Long-term anxiety will last lifelong. According to that, depending on how much one invested, but I say realistically, 1 year to 1.5 years, then one can take severely neurotic individuals to fearlessness. One can cure them, basically. And this no psychologist, no therapist, and no no drugs can do. No psychiatric drugs can do. Neurotic people are typically difficult to treat. One can do it behaviorally, so they can like to cope with their fear, so they can go into an elevator without feeling or without having to storm out, or be together with other people if there's social phobia, without having to storm away. But they still feel fear. But that's not the case with this thing. If they do this copes meditation and do it rigorously, then their fear will disappear. When the fear goes down, because there's always this fear of death, this means entails that the mind has some happiness, and then there's this fear of death that has been with us since we came to know about death with his early childhood. Huh? So if you take, even though the happiness doesn't grow, if you take the fear away, the anxiety away, then there's only this happiness. So the balance between happiness and unhappiness, it becomes widely more happy. And then one feels kind of like very independent and also beyond reach of any danger. One is fearlessness from all four directions. Doesn't fear anything whatsoever. Come as it may be. So it's a very bolstered state where one is kind of immune over for the ups and downs of life. Not because one can still be dissatisfied, but one doesn't fear anything. Or one doesn't have these anxieties. This means the phenomena of worries, this also goes away. There's no worries, because this is a delusion of anxiety and fear. Corpse meditation. Recommended. Not popular, but standard, classic, basic Buddhist training. Source, Majjhima Nikaya, number 119, Kayagatha Sati Sutta. Mindfulness or awareness gone to the body. Seeing the body, as a corpse, and nothing more than that. Not as me, not as mine, not as what I am. So much for question 164. 43 minutes in. Last question, 165. How can you combat chronic fatigue syndrome from a Buddhist point of view? Yes, first one should learn to be aware of it. The typical situation is after meals, or can be in evenings, or can be actually in any situation. One sees this lethargy and laziness arise in the mind. So one should be aware of it. As soon as one is aware of it, then one has a chance to deal with it. If one is not aware of it, then one is already sleeping at the sofa, or at the desk in the office, or wherever one is. One will seek, or in the train, seek a place to sleep, or in the car, even while driving, very dangerously, of course. So awareness of lethargy and laziness, that's when you see there's now in my mind, there's lethargy and laziness. The body is heavy, that's lethargy, and the mind is lazy. This imprisons my mind. And one sees the danger of it, the adinava, because this laziness, I don't do what I have to do. I cannot even do good. So the good I should do to compensate the bad I already have done, stacked up in my past. This I cannot do. I cannot perform the good things because I get exhausted and fatigued, depressed, lack of enthusiasm and lack of virya, no energy. So one should know this as a danger, that this laziness dominates and imprisons the mind, and this can bring one into an exceedingly sad and frustrating and painful destiny along the road. So laziness is not something innocent. It has kind of like a touch, a taste of innocence over it, because one doesn't do harm to others, but one do harm to oneself. And one doesn't compensate, pump up the karma from the bad one has accumulated in the past. So the unbalanced thing, the bad balance is not neutralized by something good, because one doesn't do the good. One cannot do the good. So the cure is, as soon as awareness of it is established, now there's lethargy in my body and laziness in my mind. This I won't accept. Then one analyzes the situation. What is missing here? Is it the element of initiative? Initiative is something purely mental. It is, for example, you're lying on the sofa. You know there's the dishes that need to be done out in the kitchen. There's a lot of mess out there. It needs to be cleaned up. You're lying on the sofa. You're half sleeping. You're dozing. Then you say, now I do it. Now I do it. So you take this decision to do it. It is where indecisiveness breaks down. And when one pulls through, breaks through to a decision to do the thing. This is the initiative. Body is not moving yet. It's a purely mental thing, but it has to be there because this is the opening. This is a breakthrough where one kind of like starts the kamma, starts doing the thing. If one doesn't say, I don't like to do it, then one will never do it. Oh, I don't care to do it, then one never do it. Then the second thing that can be missing is launching. This is right at the moment where one swings the legs out the sofa before one raises up and go out into the kitchen to do the dishes. That one launches into action, just as a rocket launches into flight. That one launches the body into movement to actually do the things that need to be done, whether cleaning or giving, or working or harvesting or teaching or whatever. Launching. First element of initiative. Two is the element of launching missing. Can be the situation when it's lying on the sofa, one keeps saying to oneself, I should do the dishes, but one doesn't launch into action. Then one falls asleep again. Then half an hour later, I should do the dishes. Then, but one still doesn't swing the legs out. One doesn't launch the body into action. So there, the initiative is there in this situation, but the launching is not there. So the action is still not performed. The laziness is still dominating the mind. The laziness is still imprisoning the mind into inactiveness, into passiveness, into non-kamma, non-doing, ineffectiveness. So which one of these are missing? If one finds out which one is missing, then one supplies that. If it's initiative missing, then one supplies initiative. If it's launching, then one supplies trains launching. Just being aware of it, then one usually launches automatically. Third thing is endurance. This is to say, now one lies on the sofa, say, I need to do the dishes. Okay, I'll do the dishes now. No more messing around. One launches, swing out the legs, walk out the kitchen and start doing the dishes, the cleaning, huh? But then after a little while, there's still some pots and pans, and they're very, very dirty, and you have to scrub them, and it's a big work. So you say, okay, I can do it later. So you only do half the dishes, or 10%, or 15%. It doesn't complete the job. Then you go back to the sofa, or some other kind of pleasure, jumping over the task. So leaving the task at hand before it's finished. Then it's lack of endurance, the third element. Lack of endurance. So this one analyzes over a long period, usually 2 to 3 years, still first seeing the laziness and lethargy in the body, being aware of it, fully aware of it. There's laziness and lethargy in this body and mind. What is missing? Is it initiative? Is it launching? Is it endurance? While doing the task, skipping out, that's obviously endurance. Lying there, wanting to do it, not being able to do it, this launching. Not wanting to do it at all is initiative missing. Whatever causal factor is missing for the kamma being performed, this one supplies. Then this fatigue syndrome will go, pass away, gradually. So this is the cultivation of virya, the factor of energy. Another thing about, if we take it a little further, now let's say some years down in Buddhist training, some years down the road, and you have started doing some tasks, and you do it every time that needs to be done, then you actually do it. There's no problem. Both initiative is there, launching is there, and endurance is also there. Then this is also a way I work myself. One can add a factor of reviewing. So having finished the task, this means that endurance is complete. When you start a task, you finish it also, you also go to the end. Start the task, you go fully to the end of the job. Finish job. Mission complete. However, at mission complete moment, you turn around and review the task. Whether it was done, how many percentage of perfect it was done. So let's say perfect is 100%. Excellent is, let's say, 97%. Very good is 90%. Good is 80%, and so on. So you evaluate your performance yourself at any job and put its percentage on. Is this 62 or 32, shabby job, or 77, fairly good, but far from excellent, or is it, now it's really excellent. Then closely, you see whenever you evaluate your own job by reviewing, looking back on it, after having completed, then looking back on it. How is it? How is the qualities of it? Then you see, are there some missing here and there? small parts here and there that could be improved. There's room for improvement. This means if there's room for improvement, then it's not perfect. Then you start working at that. This is still the factor of energy, of virya. So you can say, before, because this will mean next time you do the same thing, then you do it more thoroughly. You put more effort into it, more enthusiasm into the same job again. So you know that at the end, at the completion of the job, it'll be a better job. It'll be closer to perfection, closer to 100, pure 100% performance. This one just keeps doing, and then we'll see one is jumping up and down a little bit on this scale. If one is honest, in the start, it's kind of like there's a large jumps up and down from 32 to 57, and then sometimes 72 and maybe even 88% performance. But over the years, then it's kind of like the fluctuations goes closer and closer to 100%. So one comes closer and closer to excellence in every job. Consistency. And this is very satisfying. Because if this practice is maintained, then it becomes effortless. You don't need to, when you're lying in the beginning without energy, you need to press yourself in a humongous amount of energy to get out the sofa. But later down the road, 10 years after, you do it without even noticing it. You get these dishes done while talking about somebody else, to somebody else, you get it done automatically, without effort. The body doing it on autopilot. And then not having to put effort into the task, then even difficult tasks are felt as easy. Subjectively, they are felt as easy. And they go swiftly. It's quickly done. It's not this big, big story, I was drunk yesterday and there's a total mess inside the living room because all the guests have gone without cleaning it, and there's cigarettes and vomit and alcohol spillings all over the place, and I have to clean it alone and I cannot do it because I have a terrible headache. Then it seems like it is a catastrophic task. One has to clean up the entire mess of the entire universe there, in there. But that's not the case after this training. Then it's a minor speck of dust, gone. Now it starts raining. So much was for Dhamma on air, 55 minutes and 18 seconds. Dhamma on air number 49. Lastly, remember to click subscribe down there so you can hang on all the way home to Nirvana. If you want to support the Forest Sangha, or you want to have more information over this region, then there's a small I. There's 5 links for you to click. Thanks to the supporters. Thanks to those who gave food to me and the cat and the dogs. And thank you for your attention. And may you have a nice day. Raining it is. Namo. Tasso. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable indeed. And perfectly. Perfectly. Self-enlightened. Was the best Buddha.
You heard. Bhikkhu. Samahita, from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy. Thereby, thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha.